like, guess now, well, we are storytellers, and I guess today was to kind of give a view of the Tigerspike view of that, which is the commercial view of running a business and thinking about storytelling. The presentation is going to be in three sections. So the first section, we'll just give an intro into our sort of our philosophy and how we approach projects. The second section, Joe's going to run through some additional sort of detail around how we navigate and map user journeys and how that relates to storytelling. And then the final section is just a Q&A for any one of you to sort of ask questions. That sound good? So just as an initial introduction, would you like Joe?
Yeah, so I'm actually an ex-UTS student, so I studied, as you can see, Media Arts and Production. I think some of you have also are also studying that at the moment. I also did International Studies as well, so that was a five-year degree and I graduated in 2013. I actually started working at Tigerspike while I was still at uni, so it was about the second year of my degree when I started. It was really, from my perspective, just to get practical experience as early as possible. So I actually started as a QA tester, so QA quality assurance. So I guess in especially working in software, it's really important to have that role as making sure everything you're making actually works as expected. So I started out, as I said, as a tester, and then I later moved into project management, and also I have a bit of a background in user experience as well, so working with wireframes, user research, those kinds of things. So that's a little bit about me.
And so my story, I started off in traditional media, so starting broadcast television, then got into digital television, and then sort of moved more into sort of online, mobile, wearables and all sorts. And so I'm the group CEO for a company called Tigerspike. Tigerspike was born actually in Surrey Hills in Sydney 12 years ago. We now have 8 offices around the world, close to 250 people. And so we've grown a lot over the years, and we work with lots of different businesses. We're quite famous for, we were the business behind The Economist, the very first application for iPhone and Android. We work with businesses where we're trying lots of new technology. So DirecTV is a New York, US-based business where we're innovating with them. So now currently with Apple TV and some of the new technical frameworks that they have. We're famous for a business behind all of the Emirates, digital work and tablet and mobile work. And as the business has evolved, we're doing lots of kind of utility specific kind of things where we're trying to solve specific problems. So very locally, working with companies like New South Wales Health, and they have issues around wayfinding. So we're bringing technology in to try and help people find things within the hospital areas. So it's sort of solving sort of specific problems for companies. Our philosophy is around solving problems. We believe the experience is everything. So we don't talk about the technology. That's not what we believe in. We believe that the user sort of centric model is the right model to approach technology projects. And finally, we use data. We use data to evolve experience. So our business has been, we've developed a lot of solutions that have mobile, so a mobile element to that. And with mobile, there is the ability to capture quite unique information about users and users' behavior. And it's really important when you're thinking about digital solutions that you're looking at the analytics and you're trying to learn from that analytics to solve a specific problem or improve a particular experience. So data for us is very, very important. So how we work. So in our world, we work in very small multidiscipline teams. So what we mean by multidiscipline is that we'll have someone from technology, we'll also have someone from design, we'll have someone from user experience, we'll have project management, we might have someone from business strategy. And the idea is they work in very close collaboration with customers. And the concept of technology many years ago was let's spend $1 million and work a project for a year or 2 years' time. And that used to be the sort of traditional way. Where we work is working very fast. and very rapidly. So in a small multidiscipline team, and we're trying to deliver projects typically within a sort of 3-4 month time frame. And the idea is, rather than sort of coming up with a big scope of something, we try and focus on something very, very small, and then we launch that, and then we learn from that. So the idea is that you launch quickly, so you try out a particular feature, and if the user likes that feature, you then build on that feature. So there's a concept around launch and learn, which is being important for us. So now I'm going to pivot to Joe, and Joe's going to talk specifically then around sort of the storytelling and how we kind of work through the user experience.
Yeah, so I guess for us, I mean, Alex said it just then, technology for... technology for us is it's really driven by experience, and it's driven by the people who use it. And I think that for us, what's really imperative to get that understanding of how people use technology is really to build stories and to build journeys about these that would reflect these users' lives. So to give, I guess, a bit of a context or a bit of a quote that I think sums up this idea quite nicely is, if it weren't for the people always getting tangled up in the machinery, the world would be an engineer's paradise. So what this is saying is, essentially, technology shouldn't exist for technology's sake. There's always going to be people using it, and they're the end user, and they're the people that are going to validate it, and the people that are going to find value in these products. So it really should be quite focused and tailored to specific user or individual needs. That's when it's most effective, and that's when we know that it works for people and they get the best user experience out of it. So I guess how do we get to that point where we do know what is valuable or we do know what resonates well with individuals? One thing that we do, it's called experience mapping. I'm not sure, maybe you might have touched on it a little bit as you've been creating potentially wireframes or content hierarchy, those kinds of things, as you've been doing your own projects. But it's a way of understanding a certain user or individual's interactions with certain objects, certain places, certain times, anything really, these contextual points within their journey that you can potentially interact with the technology. So that's a bit more from a conceptual sense, but I'll just give a bit of an example of what this might look like with a kind of a simple scenario that you're probably all familiar with. So if you were to think about buying a loaf of bread, for example, when you first think about it, it's probably straightforward. I go into the bakery, I buy a loaf of bread, it's simple. But when you're actually thinking about it in a practical sense, there are a lot of other contextual factors that come into it that make that scenario actually relatively complex. So I guess, for example, if you take this scenario, think of this as a timeline. So you've just left your house, it's kind of late at night, you're hoping that the bakery is still open, and it starts raining. You're not really that prepared. You think, oh my God, do I have my umbrella with me? Yes, I have my umbrella. So you can see already that there's kind of an emotional journey that you're going on as well. So you're thinking, oh no shit, it's raining. I've got my umbrella, it's all good. So then you keep walking. Luckily the bakery is still open. You're still on a pretty big high, but you only have cash with you and they take FPOS only. That's okay because they've invented FPOS cards and you can use them at the terminal. So that's a pretty big high that you're finishing on to get your bread, and you've got your bread at the end. So I guess that's a bit of a bizarre example, and some of you are kind of laughing, but I think it's what I'm trying to say is that these scenarios are really dynamic, and there's a lot of different points, a lot of different influential factors that can influence you as a buyer, or as a user, as an individual. And I guess when you start to look at what we call these lower points, which are pain points within the actual user journey process, you can start to look at what are the solutions in place to bring that up and to alleviate that pain point. What are the enablers? And in this case, obviously, it's umbrella, it's the opening hours, and it's the availability of an FPOS card. But that's kind of what we do at Tigerspike. We look at certain processes, and we look at ways of alleviating pain points, particularly using technology. So how can technology help people's lives? So to get to that point, we really have to understand the user journey. We really have to understand what does a user do to buy bread. You can't really make assumptions that they just go there and it's a simple process. You really have to get into the user's head and understand them. And there's a number of ways that we do that, particularly with with a lot of the clients we have, they're often in industries that some of us may have no understanding about. So for example, some of the projects I've worked on have been in electrical engineering. I have no idea about electrical engineering, but in order to be able to get to that point where you can start to design a product that would be useful for electrical engineers, you really have to do your research and get into their heads. And some of the things that we do that, or to get to that point, are subject immersion. So what we mean by this is just really immersing ourselves in some of the information that they have out there already from either their own business or any of the tools that they might be using. For example, if we talk about electrical engineering, they might be using iPads already, for example, to log gauge electrical meters when they're checking the flow of the electricity and things like that. So just understanding the current processes and tools that are in place for that particular business. We also do what we call stakeholder workshops. So this is with the business as well, just to understand both their requirements from a business perspective and also the user requirements that they think they know already as well, which are quite often a fun challenge. We've also got what we do, user interviews. So these are actual sessions with users themselves where we gather information. We could be asking them about their kinds of pain points that they experience during their day-to-day life, for example, and just getting that background information to help flesh out what our assumptions are about the product.
So this sort of work is all around pre-planning. So a lot of people may come to us and say, hey, we would like to build a mobile application, and they'd like to sort of run and have a go at that straight away. And what we do is we educate businesses to not just go straight into the technology and actually really think about the user and really try and understand all of the context of where that user might be and how they might be using the device. So for example, for us, we might be working with a company where people are going to be using their service more outside. And so maybe you want to think about how, not have too much glare or keep the text much larger so it's much easier to read. There's also a very sort of finer little details that are really important before just going ahead with that project.
And then once we've got all of that information, we validate it. So we make sure that our assumptions are correct and that it resonates with users. So during these usability testing sessions or validating sessions, often what we do is we get a prototype of the product that we're envisaging, and we test it with people, so we put it in front of them. I've got some examples of what that could potentially look like from a wireframe's perspective, and I'll show them in a second, but we put them in front of them. We get them to walk us through what they're thinking. We get them to tell us whether there's any issues that they have with a particular product or any of the screens that they're looking at, and then we feedback. It's going back to what Alex said about that iterative process. We then use that feedback to then come back, reevaluate what we've done, and make some tweaks moving forward. So the way that we actually execute those activities are, or the outputs, I should say, of those activities are things that you're probably familiar with already. You might have been working with, for example, wireframes. You might have been working with prototypes. So a way of defining, I guess, what the actual product will look like is often starting out as a sketch, for example, on a piece of paper, which then may evolve to look to be something with more colour and more design involved. Again, I have some examples of how that might play out, but these are just examples of past projects that I've worked on where we've done some brainstorming. We've got some differing fidelity of prototype screens here, so we've got some sketches in the top right-hand corner. We've got some more kind of prettier things. We've done some software in the top left-hand corner. These are just some shots from some user testing that we were doing. So this particular example is from an insurance company that we worked with. So we just got the users to prioritize some of these, what we were calling belongings, so things that the user might have at home, like a Rolex watch, a wedding dress, Jimmy Choo shoes, wedding ring. And we were getting them to actually categorize those. So if they were to have all of those things in their house, what kind of categories would they give them? And that informed us how they might categorize them in the app, for example. And that was really good information for us in terms of when we were doing the information architecture, when we were starting to put labels and designs onto screens. So it can be really basic. It can be start to get quite complicated, as you can see. And there's some more as well. So there's just some other sketches and wireframes and things like that, and some brainstorming that we've done in the past. So how this actually looks on a project that I've worked on before. IAG, they own NRMA. So they recently did a project with us where we did a lot of this kind of user research, validation kinds of activities to get an understanding of what they wanted or what they thought they wanted, and also what the users were talking about, the NRMA customers were wanting from the product. So I guess I'll just give a bit of background. So we started off, I mentioned before that sometimes we conduct an activity called stakeholder workshops. So these are actually photos of us working with employees of IAG to get some of their thoughts on what they think the end product would look like, what they would like to achieve with the project, what they think their users want, and that's all really good information for us to gather up front so that we can kind of set our objectives or set our goals for the project. So you can see we had a number of sessions where we were using sticky notes. It's all quite hands-on as well. We like to keep it quite fun, not just sitting around a table talking. So we've got some people doing some diagrams up there, we've got some sticky notes happening, and it's just about brainstorming and collating ideas and getting that information up front. As you can see here are some wireframes that we did as part of that process as well. So yeah, you can just see some of the layouts that we had that were informed by some of those initial user research periods. And these were, I think, I'll show you what it looks like. It looks much better when there's actual design applied, but yeah, these are just some of the layouts of some of the screens that we did. So just going back, I guess, to tying that back into mapping out a customer experience or a user experience and what that might look like, we actually got to a point where we could map out what a user might go through in order to make an insurance claim. And it looks quite obvious now when it's up on the screen, but when you first go into a project, it's not always easy to define it so simply like this. So this is an example of a user, say, who has crashed their car and they want to be able to claim insurance back on that. So we know that they're going through a consider phase where they're thinking, who am I potentially, what am I going to do? This is obviously a quite traumatic event in my life. What am I going to do? I potentially am going to purchase insurance. I'm then going to, ongoing engagement is just them potentially interacting with the insurance company to get an understanding of where they're at with their insurance. There's the event, so that's actually the car crash itself. There's the claim, which takes place, and then there's the save and win back, so this is just talking about them getting back their money as well. So I guess for us it's about challenging assumptions, so when we go in there we're open to this information that we're getting to us and we're not thinking that we know everything about what the user wants, because often we don't, and just making sure that also we're tackling from a holistic perspective, so we're not going in too focused.
So this point as well is where we might start to consider what is the appropriate device on that journey. So for example, when you're thinking about insurance, that might actually be done on a desktop or a tablet device because you're doing sort of deeper research. But at the point where there's an event, you're more likely to be out and about, so that would be on a smartphone. And so it's picking and choosing then through the journey where the technology would fit and then the experience that fits with that technology. And I guess that's a nice tie to sort of multi-platform, and it's not now just one particular device. You generally have to be quite broad. You know, there's now wearables, there's all sorts of technologies out there, but different technologies have different strengths depending on the journey that you're in and the task that you're trying to undertake at that particular time.
So this is what the end prototype looked like. This isn't in the store yet, but it's just something that we use to test our ideas and to get some feedback on what we thought it could look like. So we knew off the back of that we were allowing users to feel educated and empowered. We knew that we were adding value, and we knew that we were also helping IAG to streamline, or NRMA to streamline their claims process as well. So I think that's a bit of a quick snapshot.
Yeah, it went a bit quicker than we thought, actually. we've got, I think, just running back, so
yeah.
We've got plenty of time for questions, and it's quite hard for us to gauge because I think you're on different courses, aren't you? And you might not have too much experience of this, or you might have loads of experience, we don't really know. But I guess on that journey, if you think about some of the early examples that we had, So things like when we're working with Emirates, what we've done with Emirates is actually map out the whole journey. So the whole journey of you thinking about booking a flight, to driving to the airport, to checking in, going through the whole airport experience, coming off the plane, picking up your bags, trying to pick up a taxi, travelling home. And we've mapped out that whole journey and started to identify where there might be points of pain for that person. You know, so they might be stressed that they might miss the plane, or they might be stressed around traffic. So how can we use technology to improve that experience? Or things like using, say, message functionality, so push notifications, so that when you arrive off the plane, you're immediately told what carousel to go to and what you need to do when it goes through customs. So all different elements, and that's sort of in the process there. We're doing exactly the same process. So we begin with subject matter immersion, because we're not experts in airlines, not at all. We do lots of Q&A with different stakeholders within the business, but also as users as well. For them, that type of business, they have many different types of users. They have business travellers, they have people that, you know, going for day trips, they have a whole mix of backpackers. And then we run that process to get to sort of solutions like these. So do we have any, questions at all? Did that all make sense? I mean, was it too simplistic? Have you got more detailed questions maybe?
I'm just curious that when you're working with different clients, how you convince them about all the research and all the energy and all the time that has to be spent before a result or a product is.
There is a lot, you're right, there is a lot of, sometimes there is a lot of education that needs to happen up front. That's part of the process, it's getting them on board with your way of thinking, because I guess you have to kind of be a bit empathetic and think in their shoes as well. A lot of the time they're specialists in their industry, not in ours. So we need to tell them essentially, we need to show them the value of doing this research. And often it's quite simple to explain to them, and it's quite easy to see when you actually do start to demonstrate that value, but it's about initiating that conversation that's often tricky. I think we do encounter this on a lot of projects that we have.
You tend to lean on the user. So you tend to sort of say, well, the users have this type of experience, and they've, through our research, they've identified these points of pain. And so if you focus on the user, it's a much easier kind of negotiation source, really, with that client to say this is going to be valuable to you, because the user has identified that this is useful for them. And that's it. Having that user-centric kind of view is something that's always good to lean on. So it's not necessarily our opinion, it's the people that use your product that are actually telling you this.
Yeah. And I think it also starts to make sense when you start to break down those assumptions that the client may have about their users. So just going back to what Alex just said, when you actually start to put in a little bit of time, you start mapping out what the user actually might be thinking or feeling, or the dynamic intricacies of their engagement with the client. The client can see, oh, I didn't know that the user would do that. Oh, they did when we were doing user testing. Oh, that's such a surprise. And then it's a bit of an awakening. It's a bit of an eye-opening moment for them. And that's the best way to get them on board and engage, is to actually show them that evidence and show them what they don't know.
Okay, just really zero in on that. Who is paying? Because people come to you, they have an expectation that you will produce the product.
Yep.
I'm hearing everything you say. I guess you don't even have to answer this question, but the point I'm getting to is I find some clients, they have an expectation that you do all this stuff for free. And that's, so how do you get that argument about, if you want to use us, this is what we have to do to start with, then we have a result, so what you're paying for.
Well, that's why you, so I mentioned right at the beginning about data. That's where data is really important. So if you build an application, right, so you saw the insurance application, and it's nice and light blue and looks, looks nice, right? That's not necessarily going to provide value back to that business. We're just saying aesthetically it looks nice, so you get value from that. But what you do is you tie anything that you do back to data. So it might be then goals that you're trying to achieve. So you might be saying, hey, I would like to get 20% more uptake in our application by launching this service. Or you're looking at specific engagement within a service. And that might, for insurance, it might be to increase the number of insurance claims. And when you can tie data back to something, the investment and the value is really easy. So we run a professional services company. Essentially, we're a technology company that runs professional services. We run a process, and of course, we get paid to do that. That's what we do. And that's, we don't really, when you can provide that value, and also from us, we're saying you don't need to invest a lot because we work fast. So you work fast, you demonstrate, and you almost say, yeah, we'll back ourselves to give value. Then it all flows, and then almost if you start to show results, people invest, right? Because they're getting, we do a lot now of work in workforce automation, for example. And so we're going into companies that have a paper-based process, and they may have, there are some businesses that we're working with that might have a 20-step paper-based process, and there's all sorts of areas where they quality might break down or communications might break down. There's one company we work with who have a process where they have to fill out some paper forms, and then they have to join a call to schedule things. And that process takes 2 hours. And they have 74 people that join that call for 2 hours. And we created an application that essentially allows them, it takes them about a minute and a half, and they don't have to join that call for 2 hours. So what you're actually doing is you're demonstrating, and this is a daily call, so you're demonstrating, you're making a saving for each individual 2 hours a day through this technology that's making them more productive. And that equates to salaries, that actually equates to millions and millions of dollars, and they've only spent a fraction of that. So it's working that kind of process. And that's why digital's really evolved around data. It's amazing analytics that you can get. And that's why that is critical when you're thinking about any kind of digital solution, to be able to sort of point back to measurement, because that's how you really know whether you've been successful or not.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I have a question. Given that you're kind of an international company and you work with the internet, do you have, are there specific programs or specific interactive elements that work differently in different countries, and that do you exchange information about that? If there is something that does not work in X place, or that, how do you feel that influences the way that you might develop a product?
There's a number of ways to answer that. I think there's definitely cultural differences, I would say, amongst the different companies. I mean, you can see from that slide earlier that we have a number of offices in different countries, and we're all obviously always trying to collaborate and work out how, especially say for example, a member from the Sydney team is relocated for a couple of months to the Tokyo office, for example. There's a number of things in terms of education that they need to be onboarded with, and vice versa. And it's, I guess for us, it's really important to continually collaborate and share this knowledge as well. So we have a number of wikis set up, we have a number of internal forums set up as well, so to make sure that information sharing process is really fluid and is really accessible. And I guess to go back to your initial question about tools, there are different tools that we have across different offices, but I think for us it's also about just what works for different processes and projects might be unique for that project. So I guess we're not trying to necessarily standardise everything.
No, and I think the world's changed, sort of on the back of Apple and the Google now and other businesses. A lot of technology, so if you look from a tech kind of toolkit perspective, it's all pretty globalized. So when you're building now iOS code, it's the same whether you're in America, whether you're in mainland Europe, whether you're in Asia. And so there's definite consistency around now broader technology sets, Amazon, Google, you know, some of the big video players, they're all pretty kind of global in that sense. I think where we see probably the most sort of nuances around the cultural component is actually around that sort of investigative and that process of even workshopping. Like we've been in Tokyo for a year and a half, and Japan, you know, I've flown there a lot, and it's fascinating. And it's fascinating the fact that the sort of the cultural way of even sharing information and coming up with digital products is really different from a lot of other countries around the world. But I think though, because of companies like Apple and other sources, from a technology standpoint, we just do everything the same. And all that. And what's been great for our company is that we've had, so for example, we've got about almost 40 nationalities in our company, and over 30 people have started in one office and moved to another. So they've, you know, started say in Sydney and now work in New York or work in London. And that's only really possible because the technologies and the frameworks that they're working from are very, very similar.
Mm. Yeah,
that's a big discussion in terms of some of those bits.
Yeah. I think also that, like, to go back to what you were saying, so the technology is moving so fast that you really do have to be adaptable. You really do have to be flexible in what you're open to use and the kinds of tools that you might be open to working with, also in educating clients about those tools as well. I mean, you have an OS update every 6 months that you need to prepare for and tell clients about, for example. That's very, very low level, but even little things like that you just need to be aware of, and it's so fast paced that you...
And that's why, in fact, when you think about the user, that's why it's so important to ask what your users want first, because, you know, they might be doing something totally different. You know, you think about things like the Uber app, you know, that's game change for an industry, which, you know, a year or 2 years ago, that product didn't even exist. So it's really accelerating. It's important to almost adapt with what people are using, what devices people are using, and think about the appropriate solution for the backup.
Do you use a lot of telephone to get data, or do you use a lot of internet when you need to get data?
Oh, we normally, right. Do you mean it as in how we actually gather
that
data?
Yeah, gather information.
Okay, we actually implement analytics within the code of the software. Just to go back to what you were saying, sometimes we do telephone calls, like, I guess, surveys or something like that, but more often than that, we rely on the actual analytics within the code to tell us the types of events that the user's looking at, the screens, the session times, the devices that
social media,
yeah.
App store reviews. You know, we built the Woolworths applications, the ones locally here, and we had a whole product roadmap off the back of reviews. So the reviews, people were kind of reviewing, and it almost helped shape our product roadmap with all the feedback that we're getting. So there's all sorts of bits of information you can get now that you wouldn't have. Any other questions?
Just like you talk about a couple of the other sort of more local projects that you're working on, because we sort of talked out in the hallway about the museum-based work.
Yeah, or industries that are relevant to you guys. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah. So that one, do you want to talk about that one? Yeah, so that's not local, though.
Oh,
yeah,
we were talking about it.
Yeah, so I'll give you a few other examples. So we're doing work with, for example, SF MoMA. So they're the big modern art museum in San Francisco. And we're developing a solution for them. So they've just relaunched their whole museum. They're doing a big launch next year. And there's some new Apple technology, which is around indoor mapping. We're creating a whole kind of interactive experience, wayfinding experience, where you'll go into a big arts venue and you'll be able to get lots of sort of interactive media for different particular locations. You could interact with, you know, the artist of that actual picture. There's all sorts of different sort of interactivity. So that's those are some of the kind of projects. I mean, locally, you know, we've done stuff at Westfield, so using technology to go into the garage without credit cards or anything, using your smartphone, using technology again to do stuff like that.
The George Institute.
Yeah, Health is, yeah, it's a good one.
So George Institute, I think they're based in RPA, possibly.
Yeah.
So they're a group that looks after, an organisation that looks after Indigenous health. That was a really interesting project because it not only had a lot of learnings for us in terms of cultural learnings and things like that, it was also really good. It was a really satisfying, I did work on it, but from what I've heard, it was a really satisfying project as well because you really felt like you were making a difference, you were really understanding the user needs and you were really contributing to something that really meant something to a lot of people in their communities.
Yeah, we also, we've done stuff, two interesting projects, and this is where technology is evolving as well. So Apple launched a thing called Research Kit and a thing called Health Kit. And the Health Kit is associated around picking up data about you, so whether that's, you know, your temperature, your heart rate, all those sort of elements. And we're doing a project with Oxford University called Total Mama, and it's about trying to understand pregnant women and trying to understand all of the data that's associated with someone that's going through pregnancy, so related to weight, and try and then start to use that information, you know, their heart rate, all other elements, and use that data to go back to GPs and doctors and practitioners to try and give them more sort of, I guess, accurate information around what state that mum might be through that process. So that's quite interesting. We did another project with the UN, which is related around the World Food Programme. And again, so that's, again, using technology in quite an extreme environment, so that's when you're out in the middle of a desert or you're, and so from a technology standpoint, you've got to think about an offline mode, like you can't act because you won't have any connectivity. So that's often what we call understanding the context. You know, there might be scenarios where you build a solution where there's no connectivity. So what do you do in that scenario? So we have to try and solve that problem. But it's very, very broad.
We're actually solve the issue of not, I think, because one of the issues here is in remote communities where, for educators, for example, is that lack of.
Yeah, so we actually.
We may have the technology and the resources, but we don't have some of the resources, like the card stuff, you know, computers or phones or whatever.
Yeah.
But then we don't have the other half that then makes the computers work. So
yeah. We used the media solution for that. So, for example, we built SBS On Demand, so the local SBS On Demand. So we built that, and it has an offline mode, which was built for people on planes. So, for example, you save up your videos, your films, or whatever you're watching, and then you go on a plane and you can watch it through an offline mode. It uses the same technology. So essentially what you do is when you're on a Wi-Fi connection, you download all your information onto your application, and then what you do when you're actually on location and it's offline, you still capture data. So you hold capture, so you get all the information, whatever it might be, and then when you get back to connectivity, it then goes back to the server and it updates again. Yeah, so we actually used a broadcast TV technique into then a real life problem. And so that's you know, that's kind of being creative with what the technology allows you to do. And we've done similar thing, we did a project with the BP, the same, but they had wind farm safety engineers. And you go into a wind farm, and I've never been to a wind farm, but if you go to a wind farm, they're normally at the top of a cliff or in the middle of the desert or whatever, and again, there's no connectivity. So we implemented the same type of technology. So it's just, you know, you play with the conditions that you're working in. And that's actually, yeah, around low connectivity, that's really the best way to solve that issue.
I imagine at the beginning you had to tell people that you were there and that you can solve or organize some sort of problems. What is do you have a lot of people or a lot of companies, organizations going to you now to do this, or you still have, because, you know, like, how do people know that you do, you know, like, that you do what you're doing?
What we do, yeah. I don't know, so we're larger now, but we're still sort of a small business in some senses. We've built work really through reputation of our work and word of mouth. But we've just, so for example, we've just been announced as an Apple. We're the only global mobile development, preferred mobile development partner for Apple globally. That's going to be announced next month. When things like that happen, so when things like that happen, then in theory, then people will know more about Apple.
And you're going to be like Oprah and tell them.
Yeah, I don't know about that, but it definitely. I mean, it helped. I mean, that would help get the word around. But it's more. Yeah, I don't know. You know, it's. There's lots of companies like that. We're not unique. There are companies out there solving problems for businesses.
But I think, sorry.
I was going to ask, were you running into many copyright issues with doing media and information?
Not really. No. Because we're not dealing with content per se. Mm-hmm. So we're sort of almost separate from content. We're not doing any content creation. So for example, a relationship with SBS. We're ultimately building, I guess, the delivery mechanism to display all their video content, but we're not sort of working through that video content. And what we do is we help SBS, so i.e., you know, we put IP restrictions on geolocation so that you can only view content in certain areas, all those sort of tricks. So we help them make sure they're not having the issues around copyright, but we're not really in, we don't really get into that.
In terms of getting your name out and developing the business, when do you target certain companies, and also when companies might approach you, are they able to clearly articulate what they see the problem is, or does the nature of that problem evolve as you develop solutions?
Sometimes do come with us with a particular problem in mind. Often what we try to do though is educate them about the value of testing that assumption and making sure that they are targeting the right problem. Some clients they come to us merely because they know that there's an opportunity for them to be putting out a digital product with some kind of, for example, mobile presence in their digital work stream, for example. I think it really varies based on how much knowledge the client has about their users, going again back to potentially how much data they have about their users, and also how well or what position they are in from an environmental sense to actually executing these kinds of strategies. I think it really does vary. Some clients are more willing to adopt new technologies than others, and I guess it really depends. I mean.
Totally. Some people have a real clear vision, some people have, okay, we don't really know what to do, can you guide us through that process? I mean, in terms of industries, I mean, we have a vision or a mission around improving people's lives through technology, and that could be anything really, you know, whether that's making the process more efficient or, you know, providing more value in someone's experience, or you know, there's all sort of avenues. So you know, the team definitely get a kick from working in health. But it's, you know, Joe's up out to somewhere I've never heard of in Sydney tomorrow to carry out some user research for a company that works in steel, right? Yeah. You know, and then previously would have been working for a big bank or doing something. So it's very very broad. So it's really different.
I think though, just also to go back to your point that you raised earlier, a lot of clients, a lot of companies are realising the importance of mobile, particularly mobile, and increasingly so. So I think that from just what you were asking before about who finds you, who does what, who interacts with who, I think there's more of a conscience about being in that space, and I think that's also really important for us, that environmental concern, like where am I making, who am I targeting, am I making sure I'm getting a wide reach, and what are users actually doing in their lives that would I guess, spur on that.
Yeah, and also sort of ways of working as well. I think that's really changed in terms of people's view of what's the best way to develop, you know, a product. And there are lots of companies who started with, you know, in terms of the startups and the accelerators, there are lots of businesses out there now. You know, I went to a briefing the other week, and there's companies, say from New Zealand, like Zero X ERO, accountancy kind of online mobile sort of solution. And there was two guys who built that up, and now they've got like 300,000 customers globally. And that's, you know, it is anything and everything now is possible, really. Very, again, it's different from where it was two, three years ago. Which is exciting for, you know, if you do get into this world and start storytelling of other sorts, there's lots of possibilities, all sorts of opportunities, because the world is, it is very global now. It's much easier to, you know, it's not just about creating a solution for Sydney Ultimo. You know, you can do things quite quickly if you get it right.
How, you know,
maybe
this from a loss for me, how often does renewal have to happen? You know, things have changed so much in 12 months, 24 months, and 36 months. The products that you're creating to help meet the need, how much can you avoid redundancy? How do you renew that?
Yeah, it's not, I mean, obviously there's reasons for, you know, constraints for customers in certain ways. I think, you know, we always, around that whole kind of launch and learn concept,
yeah.
I think if you're refreshing something every 3 to 6 months, if it's an application, for example, that's enough to feel like you're evolving and you're enhancing the experience. But it depends on the content, right? It really does. You know, I remember I did an interactive TV service about 20 years ago for MTV, and we had it in red. Colour red, and the usage went down, like it dramatically went down. And what we did, so this is a funny, a weird story, but what we did, we just changed it to blue. So we literally just changed the background colour. We suddenly had this massive jump of users because they felt it was new and different. We didn't actually change anything; we just changed the background colour. But that sort of concept, if you have something that's a bit fresh, and you know, in the storytelling world, it feels like it's slightly different each time, it will often bring you back. And that's why now in technology as well, it's quite easy to even make things feel quite fresh. So, you know, around search, surfacing content, you know, surfacing favorites, you know, special offers, all that sort of stuff. There's all those sort of tricks to actually make it feel alive. You know, and I think people really appreciate that from a customer or a user perspective.
Yeah. And I guess just to add on to that from a more like conceptual point of view, one thing we try and educate our customers or clients about as well is this idea of beta release. So the idea is that you never, well, you strive to never just release something once and expect it to be eternally youthful. You want to be constantly revising, and revision doesn't mean you failed, it just means you're progressing. And this idea of beta release means something's always in a state of renewal, or it's always in a state where it can be fed back upon.
Yeah, evolved and changed.
And evolved. And that's so important, that you're not just essentially chucking something out there and expecting it to live forever and investing all of this money and effort in something that's never going to need to change. Because that's, firstly, it's a waste of money, and it's not going to last 1,000 years, even if you put tens of billions of dollars into it. And it's just not going to be relevant either. So this idea of this iterative approach that we've been talking about really speaks to that concept as well, and being adaptive.
You can actually see that in website development. So website development, traditionally, you think about everything, and you try and cram it into, you know, have all sort of menus and sub-menus and those sort of things. And it was a whole thing where you had to have everything. And actually, reality was probably people only used 80%, oh sorry, 20% of it, and 80% of it was redundant. So there are many websites out there live now, which is still, have been built in that era where it would take 12 months to develop, and it's a fanfare, and they think it's perfect. But the view of this is different, and it's more now, okay, what are the three things, what are the priority things that we need, and let's start with that, and then build out that way. So that would always be our advice on things. And people love to complicate things, and it's actually not about that. It's actually simplifying it as much as possible. And most successful digital solutions out there, if you look at it across online, mobile, and other services, are really simple. Like there's one or two very simple user cases that you work from.
I mean, I guess you could say that about any of the apps that are quite popular. If you think about, for example, Instagram, it has quite simple functionality. It's photos, adding a filter to it, and then posting it. That's it. And I think when you start to distill what the core functionality of something is, it's much more valuable than trying to do everything that you think that your user might want to do, maybe on a rainy day, on a Sunday at 2 p.m. It's about focus rather than quantity. And that's, I guess, something that then harks back to the user journeys that we were talking about before, about really identifying what your user needs and when and why and how they might access it.
So when we did the first ever Woolworths solution, and I'm not sure it's now overcomplicated, so don't look at it, it's really complicated, they've over-engineered it now. But when we first built it, the key problem area was helping people find things in store. So that was the only thing we did. So that was essentially saying, I want to create a shopping list, so I create a shopping list. I want to locate my local store, so it's the, you know, Broadway, so Broadway Woolies, I don't know, but, you know, the Broadway store. And then essentially you press enter, and then it would then put all the products in the aisles that they're in. So it will tell you that these products can hold 4, this is in 7, this is in 10. And the idea was to save someone's time. So that was the value to the customer through that process. Very, very simple proposition. You know, they had millions of downloads within like 6-7 days just because it was so easy. So yeah, it's an important point.
So is there one theme that you identify through the years of working with different companies or organizations that is recurring? You know, like, is it services to people, or is it selling product, or is it, you know, like, is there anything that you feel that it's more prevalent than the other? You know, am I making sense?
Yeah, I think I think now it's wider now. So it used to be about, you know, a lot of media businesses would want to put video in front of people and want all those sort of features. But now businesses are thinking about internally how their workforce uses technology, so workforce, workplace management. They're thinking about technology around engagement, employee engagement, training, health and safety. And then they're also thinking about their customers and building products for their customers. And they're even, I mean, we're doing some work with a major bank here in Australia where they're looking at their physical kind of processes and even creating new digital products. Actually creating new products, and that's a thing. But I don't think there's one trend. I think the trends are that people are changing their view of work,
using them
and how we work, and they're getting more open to moving fast, like the terminology around working rapidly, multi-devices, and multi-platform is very, you know, relevant to this day and age, right? Most people have got a smartphone, maybe got a tablet, use a desktop. Has a laptop, might have a smart watch, might have a smart TV. It's all sort of interconnected in some respects.
I just have one final question, maybe before we need to pack out. But for people wanting to sort of join this particular industry, or sort of find their way into working in sort of either technology or these types of companies like yourself, what are some of the skills or knowledge that you would expect people to have as
Yeah, we do. I mean, we've had a heap of UTS grads over the years join the business, and also other universities in Sydney, in Australia, for the Sydney office, but also the same all around the world. I guess there are lots of disciplines now, so there are lots of areas. So it goes from project managers, so good organisers, to designers, to data analysts, so people that are good at analysing things, researchers, testers, developers, engineers of all types, engineers, iOS engineers, Android engineers, back-end developer engineers. So there's actually quite a broad set of disciplines. I think in terms of applying for jobs, so most businesses are always looking out for good talent. In the businesses that I know, our business is always looking out for good talent. I think a good cover letter means a million, like, because you get so many inquiries and so many recruitment agents. But I've always hired on, if someone, you know, like the very first time I got connected with UTS was I did a lecture here about 9-10 years ago, and I ran this not like this, something else. But and I got a couple of inquiries, but one of the students actually, you know, took a bit of time and was thinking about what he was doing and what he was interested in and his career and what he wanted to do. You know, it was a, it was really well thought out, and you know, he got the job, he got it, you know, he's had a great career off the back of that. And I think so that's really important. I think it's important to think that, you know, you're one of probably 1,000 people that will be applying for similar things, so take the time to think through, be a top tip. But it's definitely, yeah, always evolving, so lots of opportunities and lots of areas to grow and evolve in the industry.